All right, so like Sheila said, my name is Jose Martinez. From my name and my accent, you probably see that I'm not from here. I am from New Jersey. And so today I would like to tell you a little bit about computer engineering and what I call self-optimizing computers and the research that we do. All right, so let me just run a quick quiz. So do you think it's true that computers are really smart? Who thinks that that's true?
Me?
Okay.
Somebody
has a
reason.
Who thinks that's not true? I was expecting that. actually, that's humans. Not some of them anyway. Computers are really fast. Okay, so in reality, I don't know if you've ever seen it, but Steve Jobs used to have a great talk about how the computer is like the bicycle for the brain. That makes the humans so much more efficient because they can do very fast what computers, what humans are very slow. Okay? Is it true that computer engineers are nerds? Yes? No, you got it all wrong. That's computer science. Make sure you never get that wrong. Okay? By the way, all my degrees are computer science. Okay. Is it true that computer engineering is the coolest area in DC?
Absolutely
no. No question.
No.
Okay, so what is computer engineering anyway? So computer engineering, generally, I would define it as something that combines electronics and computer science. Okay, so how to run the programs on a bunch of transistors so that they can carry out the tasks that you want fast and correctly. All right, so a computer engineer focuses on not only on how the computer itself works, but also, very importantly, how you integrate that into the bigger picture. At the end of the day, the important thing is to solve a problem, right? It's not just the computer in itself, it's just a tool. And you can find computers everywhere. They used to be a niche instrument relegated only to national labs that would run weapon simulations, weather prediction, etc. But now you have them in data centers, in Microsoft, Google, etc., all the way to your portable devices have several microprocessors inside. Your car has tens of computers inside it. So it's really, really everywhere. What is a computer? So in a single slide, okay, a computer looks something like this. It's basically a piece of hardware that gets instructions of what to do from memory and executes these commands one after another using data that it reads in to carry out an operation and then spits out back into the data. And eventually that leads to some meaningful result, which would be that weather prediction or something else. That's my research group, okay? M3 used to mean something else, but today I decided that it's gonna mean Martinez Mean Multiprocessing Research Group, okay? So basically, I was thinking about how to express this when we are talking to federal agencies or something. I don't usually say this. But here I would say that actually what we do research is on how to avoid what a lot of current designers I think fall into, which is they waste resources and they waste talent. And the reason why I say that is that if you look at the history of microprocessors, one of the things that has happened is that microprocessors used to basically ride on technology evolution and get faster and faster almost for free. And as a result, people kept throwing at the microprocessor more and more resources. And once the technology made it impossible because of power constraints and other types of impediments, right at scale, suddenly people realized that they had this big hog in silicon that was completely wasteful and it wasn't efficient. So recently, industry has moved into this multi-core paradigm, which is essentially that instead of growing performance by making faster and faster processors, what you're going to do is to throw more and more processors on one single chip. And then these processors will have to cooperate to resolve a task. And that's very, very hard. It's a very, very hard task. You can imagine and it's a task that is inherently not scalable. So what do I mean by that? Imagine that, for example, you're the mayor of a small village. Okay, and you know, the people in the town hall is your cousin, your brother, and your father, no? And so between the four of you, you can arrange the businesses of the village quite well. That's an example of parallelism, okay, that works reasonably efficiently. But if you imagine that now you move and you're the mayor of New York City, suddenly you have you know, deputy mayor, and you have secretaries and vice secretaries and a lot of hierarchy, essentially you have a lot of red tape. It's very, very hard to efficiently orchestrate a large body, okay, so that they can carry out a task without wasting a lot of time. So a lot of our research goes into doing that. You have to imagine in a single chip, many processors, all of them are trying to cooperate to solve a task that's useful to somebody. When you have many, many processors, it's gonna be a little bit chaotic. You have to make sure that everything is run efficiently, okay? And that you do not waste resources. The other thing is that, one thing that we have observed is that over time, computer engineers have designed architectures pretty much in a very crafty way. So they know a lot about those architectures, they, based on experience, they know what works and what doesn't. But as if you look at, if you have a chance to look at the specifications of it, of any microarchitecture today, you will see that it has billions of components inside. So intrinsically, if you think about it, a human being wrapping their minds around billions of components and trying to make something efficient out of it sounds very unlikely. And that's why I say here that designers usually suck at that, and actually it's mathematically provable. Okay, so for example, some of the problems that you have to solve inside, like the problem of memory scheduling, how do you issue requests to that memory that you saw before from which you read data, that's in computational theory, that's called an NP-hard problem. Emphasis on the word hard, okay? So it's, you can prove mathematically that it's really, really hard no matter how hard you try, okay, or how many people you throw at it. So our idea in our group is to build artificial intelligence right in the chip. So that the chip, when it runs, initially it has a very vague notion of what it has to do, but over time, as it processes the programs, it learns by itself automatically how to do things. Okay? And the analogy is almost like, imagine that the processors that we build are like babies. Okay, so for example, what I have here, and I won't go into the details, but what I have here is one thing that we were successful at building. This is called a reinforcement learning agent. And reinforcement learning, basically what it does is, instead of giving you an immediate, instead of going for immediate gratification at what is the best way to go about a problem, it tries to compound over the long term what is your best action. If you imagine a baby, for example, that's trying to learn to drink, okay, the baby initially will see a glass full of water and will be thirsty, and, but when they try to bring the water to them, they will spill it all over. And over time, the baby will learn that by being more careful, slower, being thirsty for a little longer, actually will end up drinking a lot more water. Okay, so that's kind of a delayed gratification. And so we have designed hardware that can do that automatically and learn automatically for experience to attack very complex problems based on that formulation. So about freshman project. So we have undergraduates in our team. I have about three now. It's a very rewarding experience both for the students and for us. We require quite a bit of knowledge and also simulation infrastructure, so that takes a while. And so students stick with us for a couple of years at minimum. But for people that are starting, I thought about this project. So this is a donation that we got from Cadmium Networks. These are two boards. We actually just unwrapped them today. Okay. Each of these things is a cooling fan that's the size of my fist. Okay. And inside that there is a microprocessor chip, and that microprocessor chip has 32 processors in it. So it's a total of 64 processors. And so the idea of this project would be for a freshman team. To get them up and running, connect them to the internet, and then develop an execution environment so that any Cornell student that wants to sign up for classes, for example, with this board, can create parallel programs and execute them and see if their programs execute well, if they scale all the way to 64 processors, et cetera, et cetera. So I think it's a very cool project. I realized that they are saying to you that this is something that's gonna happen in the summer, but actually I need students right now for this. So if you're interested, you can come talk to me.